Good morning. When we were kids, we'd play games, and we'd at the end, we'd say, ollie, income free. That's what I felt like saying this morning. Everybody, welcome. Anyway, good to see all of you here this morning. I'm Pastor Milt. I try to ride herd over this group. No, I can't say that, but it's good to have you here. And it's the day the Lord has made, and we're called to rejoice and to be glad in it. Our call to worship, I'm going to choose Psalm 8 this morning. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. You've set your glory above the heavens. From the lips of children and infants you have ordained praise. When I consider your heavens and the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars that you have set in place, what's man that you're mindful of him and the son of man that you care for him? You made him a little lower than the heavenly beings and crowned him with glory and honor. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. The peace of Christ be with you. Why don't you stand up and greet one another? Okay, O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. We'll start out with singing Majesty.
Thank you.
have a seat. So God is faithful, and yet so often we are not. And we come to worship and we say majesty, and yet we need to kneel in front of that majesty and say, whoa, we've kind of missed the mark. So I'd invite you to do that at this time. Let's pray together. Lord, this is your space. This is your sanctuary. And you are faithful. And we meet you here every week. Forgive us when we forget your faithfulness. And bring us back to you. Hear our prayers, because we pray them in Christ's name. Amen. And then hear these words of assurance. This is from Ephesians. But God, who is rich in mercy, out of the great love with which he has loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. For by grace you've been saved. It's through faith. It's not your own doing. It's a gift of God, not the result of works, so that no one can boast. Believe this gospel, the good news, and go forth to live in peace. Let's stand and sing together. Oh, Master, let me walk with you. You guys are sitting down. If we could have the kids come on up. Got a little children's message for you. Ooh. Not going to make you jump. You want to jump? There we go. There. How are you guys? Good. It is so good to see you here today. That's pretty fantastic. Tell me about how you make a path. Have you ever made a path? You want to go somewhere, but there's not really a sidewalk to get there. So you take a shortcut. Yeah? No? You don't take shortcuts? Tell you what, when I was growing up, and we wanted to get somewhere like to water, a stream or something, we would look for a path that an animal made, like a wild pig or a deer, because they had to go to water sometimes, and we would walk along and we would... What?
They only go out at night.
They only go out at night? Okay. Well, I went out in the daytime. They still make a path, right? Yeah. Because their feet still have to touch the ground. And that's the way that roads were first made. Did you know that?
No.
Animal tracks, and they follow, and a lot of times it's the straightest way or the shortest way or the easiest way. It goes around a hill instead of over it. And there's roads nowadays, like Highway 60. It's not on a square with east and west. It goes at a diagonal. It follows the river. And pretty soon other people started following those paths. And then other people joined them. And then pretty soon there was horses that started walking down there. And they'd take their horses. And then they would take oxen and cars. And pretty soon it becomes a highway. Okay, now, where am I going with this? The Bible says that God's word is a light to our feet and a path for us. And the more people that walk down that path, the bigger it gets, the more well-worn it gets. And you guys get to make a path this morning. Did you know that? A path to a Sunday school room.
My brother made a path.
Your brother made a path?
Actually, at McDonald's.
At McDonald's? A pathway straight to the shake machine? To the fries?
No,
Domino's. Oh, Domino's. Okay, I can't hear very well this morning. Thank you for sharing. Domino's. So a path to the pizza place? Over there? Okay. Oh, with Domino's. Anyway. Pathways. You guys get to make a path. And it goes right back to that Sunday school room. And the more people that go there, the more people you'll have with you. And that's kind of cool. And God's word is a light lamp to our feet and a light to our pathway. So the more we read the Bible, the more it shines on where we're going. And the more we learn about the Bible, the more it shines on where we're going. So thank you for coming up. And can you pray with me? Dear God, thank you for Sunday school. Thank you for children to go, and thank you for your word that leads us. I pray that you will help us to follow. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you for coming up, and Mrs. Sycama, I think we'll have an announcement about that later on, but here's some candy. Oh, you got to stay up here, because we're going to have birthdays this morning. So take your piece of candy, and we'll go that way.
It's Camden's birthday.
Yep. Camden's birthday, is it?
It was. Camden, was that yesterday, your birthday? And how old did you? 9. Ooh.
I'll let you through here.
Camden, can you come on up by me? And not just because it was your birthday yesterday, but what grade are you in this year?
Third grade.
Third grade.
Okay. So the tradition here at the Arch Reformed Church is that when you go into third grade, we are going to give you your own Bible. So that is yours. And as Pastor Milt said, a Bible is a great way on the path to God. So I want you to read that. And in Sunday school, we'll use it and, you know, to help us out with some of the questions and stuff. So I just want you to have that, okay? Okay. Thank you. And you guys, some of you got it last year. Those that are young, just Maverick's the only younger one up here. You'll get one in a few years too. So, okay. All right. The other thing is birthdays. So we didn't get them done in August since I was gone. So if you had an August or a September birthday, and there's two of you guys up here, aren't there? Would you please stand? And you guys out there too, because I know who you are. Yes? Okay, good. All right. We kind of got a nice group of them this time. Okay, so Elida's going to play the birthday song. We're going to sing, and we will give out prizes for birthdays.
Thank you.
birthday, buddy. If I do this right, we can have some announcements. I think so. I don't know.
Yes. Okay. For all the children, 3 years old through sixth grade, we're going to do something a little different this year for Sunday school. So about 10:45, I'd like you to line up by the banner on the back side wall, and we're all going to go into Sunday school together. We're all going to meet together at the beginning, and then we'll divide about halfway through the Sunday school time into our two groups. And it's going to be a lot of fun this year, so I'm glad you're here this morning, and we'll have more with us next week. So 10:45 by the banner.
Does that mean I get to come too? We're going to have a lot of fun. Oh. Any other announcements that anyone would have? Patty.
This is your last Sunday with us for a little while. You will be going on vacation.
That's the plan. You're going to tell me what I'm doing. Okay, thank you. Is that the way it works, Greg? She tells you what you're doing? Oh, okay.
We're going on vacation for a few weeks, so we want to wish you a happy vacation. It's so well deserved. You've lost your brother this year and a nephew, and you've had some hard times, and here in church we've had some hard times, and it's great that you can have some time, you and your wife, to yourself, to go enjoy, relax and enjoy, and just have a good time. But there's one stipulation, that you come back.
That's a stipulation, huh? So if I don't leave, I don't have to come back? Sherry's going to, yeah. She wants, she's put her foot down. Did you hear the stomp?
So have a great
Thank you.
Safe travels, and we'll see you when you get back.
I appreciate that. Thank you very much. I will be gone for a few weeks, and everything's covered as far as people in the pulpit, so as long as you still like me when I get back, that'll be a good thing, I guess. There is a block party coming up on Wednesday, so be there. And I think, I don't know, Don, is everything all set for that? It will be?
Yeah.
It will be. If anybody wants to help serve, show up around 5 o'clock-ish. Okay, so, and there will be pie arranged for at the community church over that way, so that'll be dessert following, and then even after that, there'll be some more sweet things called the consistory meeting. Consistory meeting at 7:30-ish following the block party. Anyone else have announcements? Stephen. Funeral was Friday, okay.
So she's at peace now, no longer suffering the battle of cancer that she has for the last 6 months. So.
Okay. Thank you for sharing. Appreciate that. I actually had it written down, but wanted to make sure you shared. So, Jeff DeCook, he had his appendix kind of taken care of. It exploded, well, didn't it totally explode on him, but it swelled up big time. And they went in and they poked him full of holes and they blew him full of air, and so that's the way they do it with that, whatever it's called. There's a word for it. Anyway, he's still in the hospital, hopes to come home today. He was a hurting unit yesterday when I went to talk to him, but I think he's doing okay, and thank you for doctors. Anyone else? OMO, that's what you started out with. Okay. Lesson 2 tomorrow. Where is that meet? Where do they meet?
Fireside room.
Fireside room here. What time?
7.
7 o'clock. So. Anyone else? Betty. Okay, grandson 4 and a half is having some health issues, and his little sister is going to get a helmet. Okay. She's 6 months old. She needs a helmet. Okay. You guys are good at holding people in prayer. So thank you for doing that, and let's pray together. Lord God, your hands are good hands, and they hold us. In the midst of a sandwich generation, when we worry about our parents and our kids, I pray for those who are in that situation. Give them strength and stamina. Your hands are good hands when they work through the hands of a doctor. We continue to pray for Jeff and Michelle. Ask for your healing touch, and we thank you for guiding hands of surgeons, even in the midst of an emergency. Your hands are good hands, Lord, and we ask that you would hold them. Hold the grandson who's 4 and a half, facing health issues. And the 6-month-old sister who needs a helmet. I pray that you would give wisdom and guide the hands of those doctors as well. Your hands are good hands, Lord, and they hold us in times of life and in times of death. And we thank you for the peaceful passing of Aunt Patsy, and that she is now at rest. Thank you for the beautiful weather that you gave for the funeral. Thank you for the beautiful weather as we transition into fall. Lord, your hands are good hands. And they hold us and they hold our consistory as it makes decisions this coming Tuesday, Wednesday. They hold us as we go on vacation. They hold us in life and in death. Thank you, God, for being the one who holds us. And teach us also what it means to pray the prayer that identifies us as those who follow you. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sin, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Let's give to God our tithes and offerings as we sing, Be Thou My Vision. Thank you. Lord, we ask that you be our vision. Give us a vision of all things coming from you and a vision of your blessing them as they go out to bless this world. Thank you for these gifts and for each giver. We pray in Christ's name. Amen. Go ahead and have a seat. So we're not in the middle of a series, and we're going to come to the end of a life, the last chapter of Moses' life, and we're going to find it in Deuteronomy chapter 34, and basically it's the whole chapter. Before we begin, let's bow in prayer. Lord, these are your words, written on papyrus, written in a book, printed on the screen. I pray that you would take them out of those various materials and write them on our hearts. Help us not just to hear, but to truly listen to what you have to say. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So this is the last chapter of Deuteronomy. Moses climbed Mount Nebo from the plains of Moab to the top of Pisgah across from Jericho. And there the Lord showed him the whole land, from Gilead to Dan, all of Naphtali, the territory of Ephraim and Manasseh, all the land of Judah as far as the Mediterranean Sea, the Negev, and the whole region from the valley of Jericho, the city of palms, as far as Zoar. And then the Lord said to him, This is the land I promised on oath to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, when I said, I will give it to you, give it to your descendants. I have let you see it with your eyes, but you will not cross over into it. And Moses, the servant of the Lord, died there in Moab, as the Lord had said. He buried him in Moab, in the valley opposite Beth Peor, but to this day, no one knows where his grave is. Moses was 120 years old when he died, and yet his eyes were not weak, nor his strength gone. The Israelites grieved for Moses in the plains of Moab 30 days until the time of weeping and mourning was over. Now Joshua, son of Nun, was filled with the spirit of wisdom because Moses had laid his hands on him. And so the Israelites listened to him and did what the Lord had commanded Moses. Since then, no prophet has risen in Israel like Moses, whom the Lord knew face to face, who did all those signs and wonders the Lord sent him to do in Egypt, to Pharaoh and to all his officials and to his whole land, for no one has ever shown the mighty power or performed the awesome deeds that Moses did in the sight of all of Israel. So ends the reading of God's word this morning. So I want to take us all on a bit of a trip this morning, and I need you to use your imagination. I'm going to throw in some pictures up on the screen to try to help with that. But let's imagine you're a tourist and you've gone over to the Holy Land. And this was a few years ago because, well, Israel was not at war. And so you could get to some of these touristy places. There's a hill just outside of Jericho that's something of a tourist trap. And if you've ever been outside of the United States, especially in a third world country, you know this kind of a place. There are young boys who work the crowd, and they sell water, bottled water, and they sell scarves. And they pull them out and say, 20 shekels, but for you, special person. For you, pretty lady, only 10. Only 10 shekels. And you can get a donkey ride. Maybe. There's our Negev. There's a donkey ride. You can get a donkey ride for 5 shekels. And for another 5, they'll actually take your picture on the donkey. And women are selling falafel. And falafel is a fried, deep-fried ball of chickpeas. It can be spicy. It could be fava beans, but chickpeas are normal what it is. And women make in this makeshift roadside stand. And the recipe dates back to biblical times. And of course, each woman that you go to says, hers are the best. Hers are the best. So you grab from her. And there's an old man. who's dressed in traditional Middle Eastern garb, and he's selling panoramic photos of the eastern horizon just over there. And he marks an arrow on the spot where Moses lies buried. And it all feels pretty hokey, like most tourist places. But if you face east and you look towards the Jordan River, you can see, let's try the next one, the biblical plains of Moab. Presently, it's in the country of Jordan, and you can see off in the mountains, off in the distance. And somewhere over there in the distance lies the grave of Moses. It's just over there, although nobody knows exactly where, except for, of course, that old man who's selling photo. He knows. He knows. What a tantalizing sight that must have been for Moses. There it was, stretched out before him, Canaan, the promised land. A long 40-year trek had finally come to an end. This exodus from Egypt, it was finally over. And tomorrow morning, the Israelites would break camp, and they would all cross over to the Jordan River into the promised land. That is, everyone except for one, Moses. This is the land which I promised on oath to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob, says the Lord. I promised that I would give it to your descendants. I have let you see it with your eyes, but you won't get to cross over. And so, says Deuteronomy, Moses died there in the land of Moab. He was buried opposite Beth Peor, and no one knows the place of his burial to this day. That's quite a view, isn't it? Standing there on the hillside outside of Jericho, and you look out over the Jordan River and you think to yourself, somewhere over there, standing on another hill, Moses looked right this way, right to where I'm standing right now. It's quite a view, isn't it? Okay. That's another picture of it. Doesn't seem fair, does it? That Moses, who freed the people from slavery in Egypt, Moses, who gave them the Ten Commandments, Moses, who led them for 40 long years through the wilderness, it seems unfair that he doesn't get to set foot in the land promised to him, the land of Canaan. But just because we don't see the fulfillment of God's promises doesn't mean that the promises will go unfulfilled. Having faith in God sometimes means following God toward a vision which, at the end of your life or the end of your efforts, still remains just a vision. Sometimes it's not for us to reach the fulfillment of the vision. Sometimes God's role for us is just to keep that vision alive until somebody else gets to come along and picks up where we left off. And in the end, God always keeps his promises, doesn't it? Doesn't he? But that doesn't necessarily mean that we're going to be there to see it. I think there's a deeper lesson to be learned here, which is that no matter how long our lives may be, no matter how industrious or talented we may be, there will still be unfinished business when we come to the end. You never really get to make it to the promised land, so to speak. At least not this side of eternity. There's always a little further that you could have gone. There's always a little bit more you could have done. After his father died, he and his sister cleaned out their dad's apartment. And you feel kind of guilty sorting through someone's personal things, even if it's your own father. And they rummaged through his desk, and they found canceled checks, and they found receipts, they found letters. They found his army discharge papers. They found photos of the two of them when they were kids, photos of his ex-wife, their mom, who had divorced him 25 years earlier because of his drinking. You know, those little pebbles of living that we all kind of collect as we walk through life. And one very memorable artifact that they found on his desk was a notepad. I think we have a picture of one similar to it. The man kept it all these years. Still has it, in fact. This one was about 3 inches wide, 6-7 inches long. It's the kind of pad that you write your grocery list on. And printed across the top of each page, as you can see, in big, bold letters, it says, "Things to do today." And in his small, neat handwriting, his father had actually written on the pad some of the things he wanted to do today, which obviously he didn't get to. And we all come to the end with a list of things to do today in our life. Things we meant to do, but somehow never got around to actually doing. Like Moses, we just never got that far. And none of us ever accomplishes everything that we want to accomplish. None of us ever really gets to the promised land. I read, it wasn't all that long ago, I read that the composer Mozart, probably heard of him, died at the age of 35. 35. Think of all the music that died with him. And all the symphonies that were in his head, but they died with him. He didn't get to write them. Or the British poet, his name's John Keats. You probably studied him in high school, probably wanted to forget him too, but he died when he was 26. Imagine all the poems that he never wrote. 26 years old. Abraham Lincoln. I mean, talk about dying within the sight of the promised land, within the sight of his vision. Lincoln died less than a week after Ulysses S. Grant accepted General Robert E. Lee's surrender at the Appomattox courthouse. Less than a week. And in the last sermon of his life, Martin Luther King Jr. famously said, "I've been to the mountaintop. God has allowed me to go up on the mountain, and I've looked over and I've seen the promised land," says Martin Luther King. And he was talking about the exact same passage that we read this morning. "I've seen the promised land, and I may not get there with you, but I want you to know that we as a people will get there, the promised land." And the very next day, on the balcony of the Lorraine Hotel in Memphis, Tennessee, King was assassinated. Everybody comes to the end with a things to do list in their pocket. Every politician that leaves office, every coach that leaves a team, every pastor that moves on to another church or another vocation or maybe retirement, every one of them leaves something on his list. And they're all like Moses in that they can see out there where they would still like to go, but they can't get there. This is as far as they get to go. I think it'd be a good thing to make a concerted effort to reduce the unfinished business in our lives, to check off as many of those things to do today as we can. And this morning, I'm especially thinking about the unfinished business that we have with the people in our lives. Maybe there's an upcoming anniversary celebration, or looking out over the perceived promised land of the next 5 years for this anniversary. Or maybe it's all the news stories of senseless killings and untimely deaths that we've had. Or maybe it's the memory of the lives of the people that we've lost in church or in the community over the past couple of years. But I've been thinking about how if we were to die today, there would be somebody in our lives who would have to hear us say something that we needed to say. But we just never got around to saying it. It's still right there on our list of to-do things. I don't know who that person is in your life. I think I know who it is in my life, maybe a couple of people. It's the person who needs to hear you say, I'm sorry, or I'm proud of you, or thank you for everything you've done for me. Or maybe it's, I love you, or I accept you, or I forgive you. Won't you please forgive me? And we all have some unfinished businesses to get to with people in our lives. And a part of me worries that we may wait until it's too late to get to that list. At Washington and Lee University, this is in Lexington, Virginia, they give tours of Robert E. Lee's study. After the Civil War in 1865, Lee became the president of what was then called Washington University. He held that post until he died unexpectedly in 1870, at which time the school was renamed Washington and Lee University. I think we got a picture of the study. They give you tours of Lee's study. And you stand behind a railing and you can look into what was his office at that time. Not a particularly fascinating place. You got a desk, you've got a couple of chairs, you got a filing cabinet. If you look closely, I think there's a pair of eyeglasses on that table. Pegs on the wall to hang a coat and a hat. Just the kind of things that you would find in most anybody's office. But the room becomes a lot more interesting when the tour guide informs you that everything in that study remains exactly as it was on the day in 1870 when the great general walked out of his office for the last time. And apart from dusting it, nothing's changed. And when you hear that, all of a sudden you begin to look at that office with new eyes. And it gets you to thinking, someday I'm going to walk out of the room for the last time. The way that things are, that's the way they're going to stay. Because I'm not going to come back and tidy things up and take care of unfinished business. I won't be able to get all those things on my today list that I haven't taken the time to do. I think we've seen his office enough. I think it'd be a good thing to do when we leave our office, or our home, our church, maybe our breakfast table. I think it'd be a good thing to stop and look back. How are things in my life right now? What's the condition of that room? Are things just as I would wish to leave them and never change? Is my relationship with my spouse, my children, my parents, my friends, is it just as I would wish to leave with them? Is my relationship with God just as I would wish to have it? Apart from dusting, says the tour guide, nothing in the room has been changed. And it gets you to thinking, someday we're all going to leave the room and we're not coming back. And the way things are with other people is the way it's going to stay. Which is all the more reason to take a long, hard look at the people you talk to or you need to talk to on your things to do today list. People. One other thing that the story of Moses says to me is that ultimately it's God and God alone who makes the determination of how completely we have fulfilled our purpose for being here on this earth. And what I mean by that is, to our way of thinking, it's sad that Moses died when he did. He was so close, and yet so far. And it's like Moses' life was tragically unfulfilled to our way of thinking. But remember what the text said about him. There was never another one like him. Since then, no prophet has risen in Israel like Moses, whom the Lord knew face to face. How could we ever think that such a life as that was unfulfilled? Somebody who had that kind of a relationship, that kind of a bond with God? I mean, we live in such a secular culture that we're prone to forget that the Bible has a way different criteria, a way different standard than our society when it comes to evaluating the success of a person's life. Our culture evaluates life on the basis of how prominent somebody becomes, or how much wealth or fame they accumulate, what ratings they get in the latest poll. Sometimes I listen to sports radio or I watch TV sports, and I'll continue to do that, but I get rather tired of this life or death importance that this one particular game has. These announcers have to attach it to this particular game, whether a pitcher should have made the All-Star team, or what shoe contract LeBron James is going to get, really? Or whose injury is going to have the most impact on the team's chances, as though that is the ultimate measure of a human life. And Christians believe that conformity to God's will is ultimately the only standard or criteria that matters. And by that criteria, the life of Moses was anything but unfulfilled. At the end of his short life, with almost his last breath, a penniless, beaten, crimson wreck of a person hung from a cross. A young man, Jesus, utters these words, "It is finished." What was finished? Everything he ever wanted to do in his life was finished? Every goal that he had ever set for himself, was that finished? Every good deed that he wanted to do, every sermon he wanted to preach, every sickness that he ever wanted to heal, was that done? I don't think so. At least not humanly speaking. Even Jesus died with a things to do today list in his pocket. Even he had unfinished business on his desk. What was finished was the perfect conformity with what was God's will for him. And with his death on the cross and subsequent resurrection, Jesus has made a way for people in every age, including ours, to be forgiven of their sins and to be restored into a right relationship, a saving relationship with God. Now, a casual bystander at the cross might have looked up at this young man hanging up there and thought, "What a shame. What a tragically unfulfilled life." But has there ever been a life more finished, more fulfilled, more completed than that one? Don't feel sorry for Moses, standing there at the top of Mount Nebo, staring off into a land that he would never enter. And don't feel sorry for Jesus, a young man hanging on a cross. By God's standards, those lives were finished. They were successful. They were complete. And in the end, God's standards are the only standards that really matter. In closing, in Matthew's gospel, there's a parable about two sons. This is not the parable of the prodigal son and his brother. That's in Luke chapter 15. This is a parable in Matthew chapter 21. It begins with verse 28. In the parable, a father says to each one of his two sons, "I want you to go and work in my vineyard today. Go work there." And the first son says, "Father, I'm going to go. I'll get there." Then he changes his mind, or he gets distracted. He doesn't go. And the second son at first kind of balks, and he says, "I don't want to go." But then he changes his mind, and he does go. And at the end of the parable, Jesus asks this telling question that echoes down, I think, through the ages. Which one did the will of his father? There are colleges that judge between students who want to be admitted to that college, and they ask which one had better grades in high school, which one did better on the SAT. But Jesus asks which one did the will of the Father. And we clergy are often judged by the size of our flock or our ability from the pulpit. But all Jesus wants to know is which one did the will of the Father. CEOs of corporations and heads of states and kings and presidents are people who wield enormous amounts of power and influence. But the King of Kings asks which one did the will of the Father. Panels of judges. They go over a list and they select the coach of the year or the most valuable player or who's best on Dancing with the Stars or American Idol. But the judge of all creation asks, which one did the will of the Father? Conformity to God's will is ultimately the only criteria that matters. And by that standard, the life of Moses and the life of Jesus were finished. They were completed. They were as fulfilled as they possibly could be. Now, how about your life, my life? Or how about our life together as Archer Reformed Church in Archer, Iowa? What criteria, what standard are we using? What's your answer or our answer when Christ asks, which one did the will of the Father? Think about it. Let's pray. Lord, we ask ourselves lots of questions in life. Teach us the important ones. Teach us what it means to do your will, to taste daily the bread that you set before us, to take daily the life that you set before us, and to do your will. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. When we did our offering, we asked Jesus, or we asked God to be our vision. Our song of response is, "Oh Jesus, I've promised to do all these things." Let's stand to sing. So people gathered here this morning, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon you and grant you peace. Go in God's peace. Amen.